In Japan 1950s, a series of massive protests rampaged throughout the country from 1959 to 1960. The protests were against the signing of the American Peace Treaty, also known as Anpo. Hundreds of thousands of people protested throughout Japan, and US-Japan relations were at an all-time low since World War II. These protests almost brought Japan to the brink of revolution. The May 19th incident was one of the most prominent events in Japanese history at the time. In protest of this treaty, people launched a sit-in creating a human blockade in the hallways of the building to physically prevent the voters and Prime Minister from passing the treaty. The Prime Minister at the time, Kiyosei Ichiro, took the drastic measure of physically removing the protesters by summoning 500 police officers into the building. The treaty was signed, and the protests had ultimately failed. This event sparked nationwide uproar. People were outraged with the Prime Minister's undemocratic actions, and street protests became a daily occurrence. While this was going on, Shochiku, one of the biggest movie studios in Japan at the time, was losing the public interest, as they were judged for being old-fashioned. Rival studios like Nikatsu were asserting their dominance in the industry by producing more youth-oriented films, which captured the attention of the public. In response to this, Shochiku manufactured a new movement called Nouvelle Vague, the Japanese pronunciation of Nouvelle Vague, also known as the French New Wave. They gave young unknown assistant directors a chance to create their own films, and that was the start of the Japanese New Wave. Art is a reflection of society, and in the case of Japan, the political turmoil, disillusionment, and discontent with the government, the entire country's instability was reflected through the films of the New Wave. Directors wanted to showcase what it meant to live in Japan, what it meant to live in this society, which was pretty much a mess at this time. This was also reflected by the New Wave's films, which did not have defined themes or motifs which made them these New Wave films. Instead, they covered a huge variety of genres all jumbled together. These films explored sexual desire, violence, radicalized youth culture, the delinquency epidemic, racism, exploration of political and controversial topics, and many more. In order to convey these themes, directors used various film elements such as natural lighting, unique framing, long takes, shaky shots, and most importantly, breaking cinematic conventions to tell stories. Directors wanted to create something that actually reflected society at the time, and in a way, threw away the old traditions created by the older generations and created something new and unique. Nagisa Oshima. Born in 1932 and passing away in 2013, Oshima Nagisa was a film director and screenwriter, most famous for his films during the Japanese New Wave. His most prominent films during the movement include Death by Hanging, 1968, In the Realm of Sense, 1976, and Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, 1983. Ever since the start of his career, he had already established himself as a rebellious, politically committed, anti-establishment filmmaker. He is known for exploring controversial topics and his critiques against Japanese society. During the Anpo protests, Oshima, like many of his peers and young people at the time, felt betrayed by the government for passing the treaty. His political views definitely had a huge influence on his films. Oshima had no unique aesthetic. His films covered a very large range, ranging from neorealism, to pseudo-documentaries, to avant-garde modernism, to surrealist farce. His films were described by a critic to often deliver a punch to the guts of cinematic illusions. And this can be seen from his film Death by Hanging. Death by Hanging, a film directed by Nagisa Oshima and released in 1968, tells the story of a young Korean man named Dar, who raped and killed two Japanese girls, and is sentenced to death by hanging. However, the execution fails to kill him. Naturally, many would assume they would redo the execution. However, R had lost consciousness, and killing him in that state wouldn't be illegal. When R eventually wakes up, he has lost all his memories. Not only does he not remember his crimes, but also who he is. The guards decide to reenact his crimes to show R why he is being executed, before they eventually redo the execution. The film begins with Oshima asking the audience whether or not they agree with the capital punishment. He shows a public opinion poll conducted in 1967, showcased that 71% of the Japanese people were in support of the death penalty. Then Oshima directly addresses those in favor of the death penalty.
Have you ever seen an execution chamber?
Like a documentary, the film slowly goes through each and every procedure of the death penalty in Japan. In this sequence of shots, Oshima uses a handheld camera to create a handheld documentary feel, to make the film seem more lifelike, as well as giving the audience a point of view-like perspective. This creates a bridge between the fictional story of the film with the real-life societal issues Japan faces, and in this case, the death penalty. The second film element I will discuss is the use of long takes. Long takes are a noticeable film element used by Oshima when displaying the interior of the execution chamber. He uses these long takes to create a sense of realism and to draw the viewer into the film. Through these longer shots, Oshima creates a rather naturalistic and unobtrusive viewing experience, allowing the viewer to fully immerse themselves into the environment of the film. Lastly, Oshima also uses framing. The composition of the film uses the blocking technique of shapes, more specifically rectangles, to exemplify the entrapment, isolation, and fear of R's character. As the camera pushes outwards from R after he is given the chance to pray for the last time, the shoulders of the guards create leading lines towards the main character. Their black outfits also create an incomplete rectangular frame around him, drawing the viewer's attention to him and establishing him as the main character. Compared to the other characters in the frame, R is kneeling down, while the other characters like the priest and guards are all standing upright. This creates a power dynamic between the characters, framing R as a vulnerable and scared individual. This is also seen by the incomplete framing created by the guard's shoulders. Rather than creating a full rectangular frame, Oshima uses an incomplete frame to establish that the fear the character experiences has not fully set in yet, as he is sat quite still and seems to be at peace in the scene. When R is being dragged to the execution room, he is trembling and struggling against the guards in the fear. The rectangular window with bars creates a complete rectangular frame. In contrast to the previous shot, this shot boxes the character in and showcases his entrapment and fear as he struggles. Lastly, the long take here is used to create discomfort, showcasing the cruel nature of the death penalty. Overall, Oshima's use of film elements in Death by Hanging is a prime example of the Japanese New Waves movement, placing emphasis on prominent characteristics such as experimentation with cinematic techniques, rejection of cinematic conventions, and focuses on political and social issues in Japan at the time. The Japanese New Wave not only had a huge impact on Japanese culture and cinema, it also influenced other film movements as well as inspired various directors. Having been influenced heavily by the French New Wave, the Japanese New Wave acted as a foundation for other movements to expand upon. The Taiwanese New Wave, for instance, was a movement from the mid-1980s into the 2000s, and the Hong Kong New Wave was from the late 1970s to the early 1990s, and both of them were heavily influenced by the Japanese New Wave. Some common characteristics they share include focus on realism,
violence,
exploration of societal issues, anti-government views, and focus on underclass or lower class citizens. The influence of the Japanese New Wave also influenced various directors from these movements. One example of a director would be Wong Kar-wai, a prominent director in Hong Kong's New Wave. Similar themes and film elements he uses include handheld cameras. He also uses unconventional narrating, where he would give actors their scripts a day prior to shooting and demands improvisation from the actors. This is quite similar to the Japanese New Wave, where actors had no scripts and were forced to improvise on the spot. His films also follow alienated and lonely characters. However, he is known to use various cinematic techniques to emphasize this, for example, through framing, leading lines, and blocking. The Japanese New Wave was unlike any other movement. It was unique, gritty, and real. It reflected the chaos and upheaval of Japan at the time. These films challenged the old traditions, explored previously unheard topics, broke cinematic conventions, and changed Japanese cinema forever.